Did you appreciate those stories? Very powerful. And in each case, both with Frederick and Gemma, as with the others who are baptized in all of our services this morning, there was a point, there was a door that each one of them came to that was both a person and an opportunity that they had to open and receive. It's the same door many of you need to do so this morning. When you think about doors, they're a part of every part of our lives. Doors literally let us in and keep us out. They lock us in and they lock us out. Doors provide privacy as well as security. They welcome us and they warn us. And when you hear somebody knocking on your door, do you ever wonder, do I want to let them in? You wonder, is this a friend or a foe? Is this somebody trying to sell something to me? Or is this somebody that wants to warmly come into my life and sit down with me and have fellowship with me? Sometimes we have doors of opportunity that we actually sense we have to walk away from. Have you ever been there? That was the case with the Apostle Paul. As we go line upon line upon line through 2 Corinthians, it's where we left off in chapter 2 and verse 12, and we're just going to look at a couple of verses this morning in the light of our time. And we're going to focus on the metaphor of the door. But here's the text. Paul says, when I came to Troas to preach the gospel of Christ, even though a door was opened to me in the Lord, my spirit was not at rest, because I did not find my brother Titus. So I took leave of them and went to Macedonia. Now, this travelogue of Paul's has to present to us one of the most perplexing, frustrating, and troubling times of his entire life. Wide open front in front of him, but deep concerns within him. He had left Ephesus in the south, and I would put up a map, but they're so hopelessly busy, the maps are. I just want you to picture the Mediterranean Sea. You've got Greece on one side, you've got Turkey on the other, the Aegean Sea between the two. On Turkey, the eastern side of Turkey, the western side of Turkey, you have in the lower part, you have Ephesus. That's where Paul was. He makes his way up the coastline and comes to Troas. And while he's there, he has the same experience as he had in Ephesus, a wide open door. People are coming to Jesus. He's preaching the gospel, and people are trusting Christ. But the scripture clearly says, even so, with that opportunity, his spirit was not at rest. Why not? The reason was because there was no Titus. Paul had sent Titus on to Corinth. Because as you recall, he laid the wood down on these people for all the problems they were having. And then there was this painful letter that he keeps referring to. We don't have that letter. And whatever he was saying in that letter, it was hard. It was a very, very hard word. And he is so concerned with the way they're going to receive it. Will they receive it? Will they continue to resist his authority? He is absolutely vexed over the situation. He sends Titus to Corinth. And the idea was, I'll make my way up to Troas. You make your way back through Troas. We'll meet there. You'll tell me what's going on. I'll make decisions from there. So Paul does his part. He gets to Troas and no Titus. He's not there. And Paul is left wondering, what has happened in Corinth? Is it okay? Has it gone from bad to worse? And the very same apostle who said, don't be anxious about anything, is, I dare say, anxious. He's human. He struggled like you and me. Have you ever had a divided heart? Where you saw an open opportunity, an opening, something good's going on here, but something else is pulling you inexorably in the other direction. Have you ever had that? I had that this morning. It happens, doesn't it? I remember several years ago when we were planting churches and we were getting ready, trying to determine before God where the next church plant was. There were people that had come from the town beckoning us, begging us to come in and plant a church. I took the church planters. We were together. We were at the restaurants. Our radars were on high. We were absolutely keen to the situation. Everything was up on the table. We were ready to go to discuss the pros and the cons, the merits, the concerns. Everything was there. And suddenly my phone rang, and it was the principal of the high school. Yeah, no kidding. It was never good when the principal of the high school called me. Believe me. And what was I going to do? I had to leave this golden opportunity to minister and see to a wayward son. My door of opportunity would have to wait. In fact, it's this text that caused one Bible expositor to write these words: open doors do not in and of themselves constitute a call from God. Who would blame Paul if he had washed his hands of Corinth and stayed at Troas? Then the writer goes on to say, God would have, unquote. So Paul, sick with concern over Titus, left this wide open door to go back to see if a former door was even open anymore. Now, if we jumped ahead in the story to chapter 7, we would find out what happened. He went back across the Aegean into Macedonia, which was in the north of Corinth, and there met up with Titus, and he just exploded with joy because Titus brought him a great report. The Corinthians had indeed repented. They'd turned. They'd agreed with Paul. It was all good. But at this point, he's sort of telling us what was going on in his life at the time. So at this point, he is fit to be tied. Have you ever been like that? Now, we're going to delve deeply into this text in the context of chapter 2, the last few verses through verse 17 next week. And it's one of the richest passages we will ever explore with great practical ramifications. But for the balance of our time this morning, and because our time is relatively short, I want to focus on the metaphor of the door. The term door in Scripture is used both literally and figuratively, just like you use it in your life, both literally and figuratively. It's a beautiful metaphor, and it's an awful metaphor. In fact, James pictures Jesus on the very threshold of his return, coming into a church that's grumbling and complaining and judging one another, and James warns the church, behold, the judge is standing at the door. Those are strong words. But I want to focus on the more positive metaphor aspects, images of the door, and particularly in Paul and Jesus' life. Paul, first of all, the Bible uses door metaphorically as the door of opportunity, or more specifically, from a scriptural perspective, of gospel opportunity. Now, Paul loved the imagery of the door. It was to this very church that he wrote, I'm going to stay in Ephesus because a great and effective door has been opened to me, meaning people are coming to Christ. But then he adds, and there are many adversaries. So you've heard me say many times, where there's a door, there's a demon. Where there's opportunity, there's opposition. But it didn't matter because the opportunity was there and Paul was taking it. He would say to the Colossian church, he would write to them, he'd say, pray for us, pray for me that a door would be opened to us, to me particularly, to be able to proclaim the mysteries of Christ. So to the Colossians, he's asking for the prayer, to pray for him that he would get these golden opportunities, so to speak. And we do this, by the way, don't we? We often talk about the open door that we get for something. But in this case, it has to do with the gospel. We do it all the time. We pray for opportunities, and we testify of opportunities or open doors that God gives us, do we not? And I've said this as well, and I'm going to say it again. No prayer that you ever give to God, no prayer will be answered more quickly than the one that comes from your heart that says, God, give me an opportunity to share Christ with someone. I was in a coffee shop a few years ago, and it suddenly occurred to me that with all the burdens of ministry, I had allowed myself to just almost forget about the unbelievers all around me, much less being praying for opportunities, I was instantly convicted while studying to preach. I stopped right where I was. I put my head down right there in that coffee shop. I said, oh God, would you please forgive me and open up a door for me to tell somebody about Jesus? I literally opened my eyes and there's a guy about 6 feet from me looking at me going, dude, are you like a pastor or something? Really? I said, yeah, do I look like one? And he goes, I'm just wondering because my girlfriend and I are, his girlfriend was on, he's doing Skype with his girlfriend. We're talking about God and how to know. The guy got saved the very next day. Just the other day, our pastors met together for prayer and fasting. And one of the pastors, just with his heart just burdened, he mentioned an individual that he had not had any contact with for weeks. And we prayed our hearts out for this individual. And within the hour, that individual had texted our pastor to get with him. Praying for these things. Powerful stuff. Jesus liked the imagery as well. And in fact, to the church at Philadelphia in Revelation chapter 3, he said this, I have set before you an open door which no one is able to shut. How encouraging is that? God has been opening doors for the gospel for us here at Sailorville Church as evidenced in these baptisms. Amen? But the same God, the same Lord Jesus who opens the door that no one can shut will shut the door that no one can open. Because that very same passage says that. And I just got off the phone recently, just the other day, in fact, with a young man. I have the joy of mentoring several young pastors in different places in our country. And one of them, my heart just aches for him because he loves Christ. He loves the gospel. He loves people. He's telling people about Jesus. And it's like the door is just shut. So don't take it for granted. And thank God for the open door that you pray for, right? People are out there. They are listening more than you think they are. Here is a missionary in Kazan, Russia, the inner part of Russia, a strong Muslim stronghold within Russia. He was a radical Muslim in heart, just as these radicals that were doing on the killing spree in Paris just the other day. And God touched him with the love of Jesus Christ, and he was saved. This Muslim, former Muslim man, has planted no less than 2 churches in the city amongst all kinds of persecution, so much so when he was in the midst of planting his 3rd, he had to send his family to another state just to get them out of that area. It was so threatening, and he himself was expelled. But here's what he said, and he says to you and me, these are his words. He says, the world is more willing to receive the gospel than Christians are willing to give it. The world is listening. Jesus died so that people could be saved. And God all around the world has got his divine foot in the door so nobody can shut it. And by the way, I love this picture that Jesus gave us in Revelation. I hope I hold the door open. Nobody can shut it. I'm reminded of Mike and Stephanie Templeton. They were not Christians a few years ago. You might have been introduced. Mike might have given you a bulletin this morning. He wouldn't have given you a bulletin a few years ago, I'll tell you that. When Chuck showed up at the door, Stephanie told us when she got baptized, she didn't want her husband to even answer it, but he opened the door and she ended up hiding behind it. She was hiding behind the door so that Chuck couldn't see her. But God did. And you can hide all you want, but if God has his divine tractor beam on you, he's going to pull you inexorably toward himself, right? No one can come to me unless the Father draws him, and God may have his tractor beam on you right now. You've heard the stories. And he's pulling you, and why are you resisting? Why are you kicking? Why are you resisting the truth of God? Let me hasten to the second metaphor of the door, the one many of us have come to love, the door of salvation. The door itself is Jesus, who said, I am the door. If anyone enters by me, he'll be saved. Jesus Christ is the door itself to salvation. You're not going to get to heaven unless you go through Jesus, period. I am the way and the truth and the life. No one comes unto the Father except through me. That's what Jesus said, not me. It's not multiple ways. It's one way. It's one door. Have you seen that Geico commercial with the three kids in the horror movie? They're trying to run from the bad guy, you know. And one of them sees a running car and said, look, the running car. And someone says, no, you idiot or whatever. Let's hide behind the chainsaws. And the big catchphrase in the commercial is, you know, when you're in a horror movie, you make poor decisions. That's what you do. Listen, some of you are staring at the great door himself. You're making all kinds of decisions, but you're making the worst decision in the world to walk away from that door, because that is the very door that will save you. If you're a non-Christian, non-Christian make poor decisions. That's what they do. The poorest decision you could make right now would be to reject and walk away from this door of salvation named Jesus Christ. And isn't it something that the door of salvation also becomes salvation at your door? That's the third and final metaphor. He is not just the door of salvation. He is salvation at your door. If it's not enough that Jesus is the only way to be saved, he is the door. He becomes the one who comes to your door. And many of you know it. This is one of the most beautiful verses in the Bible. This here is Jesus standing at virtually, metaphorically, figuratively, but real just the same, at the very threshold, at the very door of a church that once stood true to his name, but no longer. And so he says to this church, behold, I stand at the door and I knock. If anyone hears my voice, notice he doesn't say, if anyone hears my knock, he's not just knocking, he's calling your name. He's calling your name. He is calling your name. If anyone hears my voice and opens the door, I will come in to him. I'll sit down with him. I'll eat with him. I'll be with him. He's not just the door. He's at your door. Will you answer? Will you open up your door? Because some of you just so need to do that. Your hearts are so closed. You're religious, but you're lost. You're not a Christian, and you know it. In your heart, you know it. We had an individual baptized. Brandon was baptized in the first service, raised in a Christian home, prayed the prayer, but realized just a few months ago that he was not a Christian, just like some of you. And here is Jesus knocking on your door. Most of you are going to go home after this service and you're going to do what? You're going to sit down with your family and you're going to eat. Will you open up your door? Invite Jesus in to do the same. He will feed you with the delectable food of heaven. And you'll be filled as you've never been filled before. So while it was tough for Paul to walk away from a door of sharing Christ, it would be a tragedy for you to walk away from a door, the only door of receiving him. And that's our story, and that's our word to you today. Some of you have to quit playing games, the religious games, and acknowledge that you're a sinner, like Gemma, who had put all of her angst into an uncle who had abused her, but realized, in her own words, she was every bit the sinner that he was. And place your faith in Christ. Your church, your baptism, your religious this or that isn't going to save you, but Jesus will, who is the door, and yet stands at your own. Will you open it? Let's pray. Father, thank you. Thank you for these tremendous testimonies that we have just heard of your great salvation, reconciliation, as the word was used beautifully. Thank you for the stories of Frederick and Gemma. Thank you for your gospel that saved them, simple as that, and changed them and is changing them. God, I pray for those who are here right now. They've not been changed. And that's you. Now I want to talk directly to you as unto God. I ask you, would you admit this morning that you have never truly opened the door of your heart to Jesus? You've never seen him as the one who will deliver you from the danger and the sin, the disaster and the damnation that you are facing apart from him. Have you never had that time? Will you humbly, yet joyfully, ran to that door, the door himself, and yet opened your own door and received him? Listen to the word of God that says, as many as received him, and that word means to take in, as many as took him in, to them, God gives the right to become the children of God, to those who believe in his name. If you would do that today, from your heart, to the one who stands outside of your door and yet calls you by name, you'll be saved. So right now, if that's you, you feel that tractor beam pulling you in and you want it, you desire it, you can just from your heart say, Lord Jesus, no longer will I keep you outside of my life. I invite you into my life right now to forgive me and be my Savior. I'm believing in your death. I'm believing in your resurrection. Make me yours. Come in and have supper with me and fellowship with me forever, I pray. In Jesus' name, amen.